Now let's look into fluid volume excess. So fluid volume excess, meaning there's too much fluid in the patient's intravascular system. And causes of that can be rapid IV fluid administration. So for example, if this is an elderly patient who has a weak heart and their heart is not really able to pump very efficiently and they might have a certain degree of congestive heart failure. Now if we give IV fluids to them too fast, the heart is not able to pump that very efficiently. And also maybe if the kidneys are impaired, the patient's not going to be able to filter it. So rapid fluid administration can lead to fluid volume excess, as well as congestive heart failure, as I just explained. If the patient's heart is weakened and that heart muscle can't really pump the fluids into the body very, very efficiently, then the fluid tends to back up in congestive heart failure, whether it's right or left sided, into the lungs or into the body. And then the patient will have signs of fluid volume excess. Also renal failure. So our patients whose kidneys are not working properly, for whatever reason, whether that's acute or chronic, the kidneys have taken some sort of an insult where they are not able to filter out the fluid as they would usually. So then if the kidneys are not filtering, that's really our only way of exiting or getting rid of excess fluids. So if the kidneys are not functioning, we're going to be retaining more fluids, hence we're going to have fluid volume excess. Also patients with cirrhosis. So the liver is a major organ who does not really contribute that much to fluid and electrolyte balance, but if the liver is not functioning, the patients will usually get what's called ascites, which means that the fluid accumulates in the interstitial space, so that can be the lower extremities as well as the abdominal cavity. And you can look into cirrhosis a little bit more clearly here. So the patient's fluid volume excess will not necessarily be in the intravascular space, but it will be in that interstitial space, again, lower extremity or in the abdominal area, and there will be fluid volume excess in those areas. Also, excessive water intake can lead to fluid volume excess. So typically we think of water being a good thing. We want everybody to be hydrated, drinking plenty of fluids, but there is such a thing as too much of a good thing. So if you drink too much water, let's say if you drink 5 gallons of water in a day, your body is going to be completely diluted and there's going to be some consequences having fluid volume excess. So let's look at the lab values here. Now, if we have fluid volume excess, too much fluid in the intravascular or in cirrhosis in the interstitial space, everything will be more diluted because all the particles that we have now that we can measure in the serum will be floating around in more fluid than they usually are. So everything will be more diluted, meaning that our BUN value will be low, our sodium level will typically be low, so will be the hematocrit, so the percentage of blood compared to the plasma. And then urine specific gravity, again, I wrote this in parentheses here because typically when there's fluid volume excess, the kidneys will get rid of more fluid, hence the urine will be more dilute. But if there's renal failure and the kidneys are not working, this is not going to apply because the kidneys are not going to be able to filter. And then the urine specific gravity might be normal or it might actually be a little bit high. But as it applies to serum osmolarity, again, that will be lowered because every particle that floats around in our intravascular system will be more dilute, hemodilution right here. So everything, just note all the arrows point down here and note urine specific gravity is in parentheses. So patients with fluid volume excess, we will definitely have to also monitor the cardiovascular status, their vital signs. So if you think about it, if a patient has too much fluids in their system, their blood pressure will usually be elevated. Now, depending on how their heart is doing or whatever other comorbidities or conditions they have, the heart rate may be normal, high, low. It depends on a variety of other factors. But then the patient with fluid volume excess will definitely have jugular venous distension. And if you want to refer back to your textbook, then you can see how this is measured. But basically, if there's a lot of fluid in the intravascular system and the patient is sitting in bed at 45 degrees, we can measure the angle of the jugular vein. And depending on how many centimeters it is distended, it will be a positive or negative finding. And mostly in, with fluid volume excess, the jugular veins will be distended. Now, there will also be peripheral edema. If the cause is either congestive heart failure, renal failure, or even cirrhosis, there's too much volume in the blood system that that eventually that blood will push out, it will seep out from the intravascular space and just kind of sit there in the interstitial space, and the manifestations are peripheral edema as well as maybe ascites, like I explained earlier in a patient with cirrhosis. Now we'll also have to keep a close eye again on the patient's lung sounds, because there is too much volume already in their system. If the heart is not pumping efficiently, that left ventricle is really weak, that fluid will back up into the lung sounds and into the lungs, and a pretty typical lung sound in the patient with CHF or an exacerbation of CHF will be crackles in the lungs. So keep that in mind. Again, we want to make sure we watch the patient for safety, because they have this extra fluid, they might be swollen, they might be short of breath, so they're at high fall risk again. We want to pay particular attention to their skin, because they'll have edema, they'll have ascites, they'll be very swollen. If there's a lot of fluid in the interstitial space, it can actually sometimes even seep out through the skin, depending on how severe the edema is. So skin care is going to be very important to prevent any further complications. Now, IV fluids as ordered, so that all depends on how significant the edema is, how significant the fluid volume excess is. It typically, the patient will be saline locked, but as maybe the excess, the fluid volume excess is improving, we might give the patient IV fluids at just a very, very slow rate, so something like 15 mLs per hour. But be very careful and check your orders here very carefully as the type of IV solution as well as the rate, because again, if we have fluid volume excess, we do not want to give the patient any additional fluids. And then of course the patient, if there is congestive heart failure, renal failure, or cirrhosis, one will need to give put some medications in that will help us get rid some of that fluid. Now diuretics, as we know, work very, very well in eliminating some of that excess fluid via the kidneys. Then we need functioning kidneys. So in a patient with renal failure, depending on the degree of renal failure, diuretics may or may not work. But diuretics work very well for patients with congestive heart failure. And then also I wrote down your colloids or albumin as ordered. So albumin is a plasma protein that exerts what's called oncotic pressure or colloidal oncotic pressure in the system. So plasma proteins are very big molecules that circulate in our bloodstream. And what they do is they create a pulling force into the intravascular space. So that pulling force really helps to contain all the molecules and the fluids in that intravascular space. Typically, patients with cirrhosis will have very low albumin levels. Same can happen with patients with congestive heart failure. And then what happens, that pulling force of the albumin into the intravascular space is not really working properly. Hence, the fluid seeps out into the interstitial space, as we talked about, manifesting itself in edema or in the ascites in patients with cirrhosis. But then we can administer albumin via IV. So there's an artificial albumin that we can give the patient, and that will create that pulling force in the intravascular space by these proteins exert, and so it'll help reduce the amount of swelling and pull the interstitial space back in the interstitial fluid back from the interstitial space into the intravascular space. Now, one very important thing I haven't written down yet is monitor eyes and O's very, very carefully. that's probably the one of the most important things to do here, as well as daily weights. For the same reason as we want to measure that very carefully in patients with fluid volume deficit, we want to keep a close eye on their intake and output and weigh them daily. Now, if there was excessive water intake or any of these other factors, really, we might also put the patient on fluid restriction. So these are the patients that you'll see will have a sign either at the door or at the bedside, fluid restriction 1200 mLs per day. And then you'll have to be very careful on monitoring that. So in summary, fluid volume deficit or fluid volume excess pertains to either plasma or blood loss. Depending on the condition, for fluid volume deficit, you might lose plasma fluid only or blood. Everything in fluid volume deficits, in terms of your labs, will be more concentrated because we've lost the fluid portion of it, and then we went over the nursing interventions. Now, for fluid volume excess, it's quite the opposite. So something in the body is not working quite right, mostly heart, kidneys, liver. Therefore, we're retaining a lot of fluid, and everything will be more dilute in our lab section. And then nursing interventions, we talked about them as well. The most important being monitoring the cardiovascular status, as well as isotonic and daily weights, as well for fluid volume deficit and excess. So thank you very much for watching Nursing School Explained. I'll be focusing on arterial blood gas analysis, as well as the major electrolytes and what it means if they are high or low in the system, and certain nursing interventions that go along with that in future videos. Please leave any comments or topics you would like me to review in the future in the comment section below. I'll be happy to look at those, and I'll be happy to receive your feedback as well. Thank you for watching Nursing School Explained.